strength fading and my back tightening.
Slowly but surely, we're trying to get this done and accomplished. One more day. Every day is an interesting challenge, as every day there seems to be a new twist or a new way that God comes through. And one way or another, somehow, always gets accomplished that which He wants us to do. Which in our case is to hear Him speak. When you must stand against the tide, what can we do in the battle being fought for the minds and hearts of mankind? Some time ago, I watched a miniseries on television called The Nightmare Years, a docudrama centering around William Shirer's new years as a newspaper reporter for Hearst, and later a correspondent for CBS. Assigned to Berlin, just as Hitler began making his move to rule Germany, Shirer saw firsthand just how the Führer rose to such total power. Shirer was there through the invasion of Austria, Poland, and France. He stayed until Hitler began threatening England in hopes of getting them to surrender without invasion. When Shirer exposed the fact that Germany was staging an attack against England that they weren't prepared to carry through with, the Gestapo was ordered to kill him. The reporter fled for his life and managed to escape. Shirer's integrity and sense of responsibility captured my heart. He stayed in Germany at the peril of his life, stood against the Nazi regime, refused to be duped by their propaganda, challenged Hitler's henchmen face to face with their lies, constantly called the Reich's hand, and exposed everything he could to the outside world. To me, though he seemingly did not know our Lord, William Shirer was a hero and a role model and an example to many who professed to know our Lord but were swept up in the Nazi deceit. How did Hitler ever gain the power he did when the man was obviously sick to the core of his being? That question has always fascinated me. He did it by capturing the minds and hearts of the dissatisfied German people and by focusing on the youth, brainwashing them with lies. Lies so indelibly written on their minds that they even turned against their families for the honor and future of the Reichland. Young men and women were turned into hard, insensitive, brutal human beings who beat elderly people on the streets because they would not say Heil Hitler, and who humiliated and brutalized human beings because they were Jews. Hitler ruled by delusion and by fear, and those who helped him in his reign of horror justified what he did and turned the other way when the man acted like a maniac. Those who worked closest with Hitler chose to believe a lie because they did not, it would cost them their position, their power, or even their lives. Hitler also deluded the heads of nations, including England, because these leaders wanted peace at any price. They compromised what they believed. They chose to believe a lie rather than the truth, for to believe the truth would have cost them temporal comfort and security. It was easier to look the other way, to deny or to ignore what they were seeing and hearing. It was easier not to investigate and not to stir things up. They were cowards. How God spoke to my heart through this account of history. Christianity never removes us from the evil world. It leaves us in it. But we are not to be of that world. We are not to think like that world, act like that world, adapt to the world, or sell out the world. Instead, we are to contest the world, oppose it, and rescue every soul we can from it. Jesus never called us to peaceful coexistence and compromise with the world and its temporary prince. Jesus leaves us here to rescue the hearts and minds of men and women and children so that they might know the truth and in knowing the truth be set free. Free from the father of lies, the deceiver, the destroyer. Free from the adversary of God and of man, an adversary who lays in wait to deceive, destroy, and take captive the souls of men. Free from the one who tries to blind the hearts and minds of people and women so that they might not see the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ and be saved. Free from the one who lures them into sin, destruction, enslaving sin, which they are held with by cords of their own iniquity. Just in the one small patch of mail that I worked on yesterday, I have letters from two women who were devastated by what they have just found out about their husbands. Yet out of their love for God, they are struggling to hold their marriages together. Marriages which are being ripped apart because of adultery and perversion that have come because of their Christian husbands have become enslaved in pornography. A third letter from a woman determined to stand alone if necessary, told of a book which is being used in her children's elementary school. The book teaches children how to make contact with the devil, and the principals won't do anything about it because he doesn't want to make waves. Like William Shirer, these three women will not buy the lies, they will not compromise, and they will not take the road to expediency. But where are other Shirers today? Where are the people who, like these three women, are willing to seek the truth no matter what the cost? People who are willing to risk their career, their safety, their security, their all for the truth embodied in our Lord Jesus Christ. Did our Lord call us to have peace with the enemy? No. He called us to a cross. He called us to deny ourselves and follow Him no matter what the cost. For His sake in the Gospels, He told us to be faithful unto death. There are hundreds, no, make that thousands of believers in this country and around the world who are convinced and determined that we must capture the hearts and minds of men, women, teens, and children with the knowledge of God's Word so that they can know how to live, not by the world's standards, but by God's standards and God's alone. But that is not all, for it is not enough to live it. God's Word must be propagated, it must be shared and taught. Others must learn how to study His Word for themselves so they won't be carried about with every wind of doctrine and cunning craftiness of this evil world which lies in wait to deceive. They need to know truth so that they can use it to set others free. They need to know it so that they can live as salt and as light, children of God above reproach in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom they appear as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life. What we do, people can see and know that they don't have to be puppets or slaves to Satan's strike plan. Are you constantly aware of the fact that you have been delivered from the domain of darkness? Are you living in the kingdom of light? If not, why not? Don't be deceived. Be valiant warriors, and if necessary, be ready and willing to risk your temporal life for Him. Eternity waits. We have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you be filled with the knowledge of His will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to His glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. For He rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sin. Colossians 1:9-14. If you're only here for your family's sake, and you're only watching because you think that it's a religious duty, if you think that you're going to skip by and scrape by and just somehow get into heaven by the skin of your teeth, you're probably going to wind up in hell. Jesus made it very clear that those who followed Him would suffer persecution, that they would be required at times to take up their cross and follow Him. There would be choices that would have to be made that would cost us sometimes our own peace, joy, our happiness, our quote-unquote head-in-the-sand type attitude, where we would have to say, no, I'm not going to do that. For me, sometimes it's in political venues where people think that I need to do something in politics, and I say, no, I'm not going to participate in it. I don't want to, I don't have to, I choose not to. I will pray for it, but I will not waste my time in it. For others, it may be in some school ceremony or some way, somehow, some compromise that you know is wrong, that you'll have to say either yes or no to, and there is no in between. If God brings that to you today, draw your line in the sand and ask God what He would have you to do. Because if He wants you to take a stand, He'll show you where and when and how. But once you do, you will suffer persecution. But God will be with you.